Now, you're watching special election coverage from Wayne 15, your local election headquarters.
The political landscape of our country and Indiana is on the line tonight. Thanks for joining us for the 2018 midterm election. I'm Tara Brantley.
And I'm Dirk Rowley. If you haven't had the chance to vote, you still have until 6 o'clock tonight. As your local election headquarters, Wayne 15 has you covered from the state and local races. We have team coverage throughout the state.
In the battle for Indiana's Senate seat, Democratic Senator Joe Donnelly is facing Republican Mike Braun and Libertarian Lucy Brenton. Braun beat out two Indiana congressmen to win the Republican nomination back in May. Both Donnelly and Braun made stops in Fort Wayne yesterday, and we caught up with them today.
Locally, in the battle for Indiana's 3rd District, it's Republican Jim Banks and Democrat Courtney Tritch. As your local election headquarters, as I said, we have teams throughout Fort Wayne, but also in Indianapolis for this important race. Wayne 15's Kaitor Kay is live in Indianapolis. He'll preview Indiana's Senate race between Donnelly and Braun. Wayne 15's Angelica Robinson is live at the Democratic headquarters. She will interview the chair of the party, Misty Meehan. And Wayne 15's Chris Darby is live at the Republican headquarters. He'll have the latest from the Banks campaign and preview all the other important Republican races. And Wayne 15's Rachel Russell will break down the early voting results and the frustration local voters faced as they went to the polls. But we start with Wayne 15's Kaitor Kay. He's in Indianapolis, where we will preview the Senate race. He kicks off our team coverage tonight. Kaitor, what is the feel in Indianapolis?
There is a lot of excitement brewing here. We are right here in the heart of downtown, right by the State House. And just a few blocks southeast from here, Mike Braun and the Republican Party are at the Marriott Hotel. And a few blocks southeast is Senator Joe Donnelly and the Democratic Party at the Hyatt Hotel. We will be back and forth between both parties all throughout the night. The Republican Party tells us they are excited for a historic night. The war room, as they call it, is now set up, and the reception room will soon be ready. We're told Braun will remain in his suite until a winner is called. Donnelly's party is also gearing up as well. His spokesperson tells us that they're enthusiastic because they've analyzed the early voting results and it is going in their favor. Many are calling this Senate race the most closely watched in the country. And since Indiana polls close early, the winner of the race will be an early indicator of how the rest of the night will go for the Republican and Democratic parties on a national level. We talked with Braun and Donnelly going into this historic night.
You give up a lot, but I think it's a unique time when if you get more people like myself that get out of the comfort zone, that have done something in the real world, quit sending the politicians from the farm system of politics.
That's what describes me. I don't worry about Democrat or Republican. I worry about Indiana. I worry about America. I worry about making sure your children can get health care and your whole family can, that you can get a good job, that your kids can get a great education, that our troops and veterans are taken care of. When that happens, that's America.
As for Hoosiers, we've had a history of having a senator from each party, but tonight's vote will show if that trend will continue or if Indiana will become a more committed Republican state. We'll have more updates on Braun and Donnelly's parties here in downtown at 6 o'clock. Live in downtown Indianapolis, Kaitor Kay, Wayne 15 News.
Kaitor, thanks. The Democratic Party in Allen County, the state, and the rest of the country are all hoping to end up victorious tonight.
Leaders from across northeast Indiana are gathered at the Democratic headquarters tonight, and that is where we find Wayne 15's Angelica Robinson. She is live there to preview tonight's race. Angelica, tell us about the atmosphere there this evening.
Dirk and Tara, we're now less than an hour away from the time that the polls close. And here at the Allen County Democratic headquarters, people are making those last minute phone calls, trying to get those that are registered to vote to get out and vote before those polls close at 6 o'clock. Joining me now is the head of the Allen County Democratic Party, Misty Meehan. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
And so we just wanted to talk about some of the major races that we have. I know that all eyes are on two big races, one of them being for U.S. Senate, the other being for Congress. I'll start with the one for U.S. Senate, which is between Democratic incumbent Joe Donnelly and then also a Republican candidate Mike Braun. What do you think we're going to see tonight with those races?
I think that all the races are probably going to be close because you've got a lot of people that are very interested in what's going on right now, and that has activated a great number of voters. Senator Donnelly has a proven track record of coming to the aid of veterans, to coming and helping labor, and to coming and helping those who need medicine for their kids, and I think that will put him ahead.
Now, the president was in town last night making that final push. How do you think that that may impact, you know, or sway voters?
I don't think it's going to have quite the impact they thought. I think that it was mostly a diversionary tactic trying to get people to not stay focused on our mission, and we stayed focused. We have knocked, you know, tens of thousands of doors and made tens of thousands of phone calls and gotten our voters to the poll this entire week. We just were not paying attention to what he was doing.
Now, on to another race that we want to talk about, which is the race for Congress between Republican incumbent Jim Banks and then, of course, Democratic candidate Courtney Tridge. Does she have what it takes?
I think she does, because she has a proven track record for economic development for the entirety of Northeast Indiana. She's already made those connections, and she is for health care for everybody, and she's just the values that 3rd District really represents.
Okay. Well, we are going to keep our eye on those two races as well as many other local races here tonight. We will keep you posted. Of course, there's just one more hour left, less than an hour actually left. So if you haven't yet, get out and vote, and we, of course, will keep you updated right here and on Wayne.com. But for now, reporting live at the Allen County Democratic headquarters, Angelica Robinson, Wayne 15 News.
Angelica, thank you. While Democrats are hoping to take back the House, Republicans are hoping to keep one of those seats.
We're talking about the race for Indiana's 3rd District, and we've got Wayne 15's Chris Darby live from the Republican headquarters. Chris, set the stage for us, if you would.
Yeah, there's not much going on here at the GOP headquarters. Kind of setup really is just the mood of the room, if you want to ask that question. But it's a little bit different than the big presidential election cycle when they're at a banquet hall where they're watching the results. We do expect a couple hundred people here in this room, though, once the polls close, to check out those results and keep an eye on them throughout the night. We'll obviously be watching the big Donnelly-Braun Senate race, and obviously as well the race for Congress between Jim Banks and Courtney Tridge. We do expect Jim Banks to be in the room tonight, so we'll be trying to catch up with him and hopefully show you any kind of speech and remarks he might give as the night goes on. A couple other races I did want to mention that we'll be keeping an eye on as well. The sheriff's race, Dave Gladio here in Fort Wayne, is up for re-election. We're not really sure how that one will turn out. We expect that probably a big swing towards Dave Gladio. We'll keep an eye on that. Our prosecuting attorney is also up for re-election, but running unopposed. She's a Republican. Expect her, obviously, to clinch that one. We're going to keep an eye out on Tara Klutz, who's running for state auditor. It's a state race, but she's from here, from Fort Wayne and Allen County, so a lot of eyes will be on that race here in this room to see if she'll continue her time down there at the state capitol. And then we're looking to fill Linda Bloom's seat. Richard Beck is running for the Republican side in that. We'll find out tonight if that will stay Republican-controlled with Nelson Peters and Therese Brown, or if that will be a little bit of a change, putting a Democrat in that seat. We'll be keeping an eye on all those races tonight here at the GOP headquarters downtown. We'll be talking to Chair of the Allen County GOP, Steve Shine, coming up at 6 o'clock. So we'll hope you join us then. And obviously, through cut-ins throughout the night here on Wayne TV and all of our social media platforms and on Wayne.com. Live at the GOP headquarters downtown, Chris Darby, Wayne 15 News.
Chris, thanks. With so much on the line this midterm election, thousands of people have already flocked to the polls.
And some of them did encounter a few problems. Wayne 15's Rachel Russell caught up with the Allen County Election Board. She continues our election coverage now. Rachel, what types of problems did they encounter?
Well, Tara and Dirk, this morning, as many were excited to cast their vote in this crucial midterm election, a few locations saw long lines and even some voting machines not working. This morning, we received viewer reports of the long lines leading some of the people to leave before even voting. Viewers reported around 100 people in line at Emmanuel Community Church. Other delays at Animal Care and Control were also reported. The Allen County Election Board said Emmanuel Community Church was having issues with their poll pads not printing tickets. Poll workers were having to write them out manually, which was slowing the check-in process. The poll pads were later replaced. Regarding the delays at Animal Care and Control, the board said Animal Care and Control had difficulty getting their voting machines working this morning. Nothing wrong with the machines, just operator error. Board member Tom Harden said that despite long lines and those few problems mentioned, voting is going as expected.
We've had some locations experiencing 30 to 45 minute waits. In those locations, it's just a heavy turnout, and you know, we are processing voters as fast as we can. We've actually dispatched a couple of extra voting machines to a couple of locations, but pretty consistent with the heavy turnout, that sort of wait that sometimes voters do experience.
Other than these problems and some of the longer wait times, most of the polling places saw little problems today. If you haven't gotten the chance to vote, you still have some time to do that. The voting stations close at 6 o'clock. In Studio 15, Rachel Russell, Wayne 15 News.
Rachel, thank you. We will have live results for the races both on air and online. Also, coming up tonight at 6, political analyst Mike Wolf will join us. He will offer his insight on what this election night could mean for the future.
Now, your first weather from the live Doppler 15 Fury Weather Center.
Our biggest weather impact of the day, the high winds. And the winds remain strong now, sustained from the west-southwest at 32 miles per hour. And we could still have gusts up to around 35 to 40 miles per hour here this evening. Our current temperature sits at 50. We'll see that temperature gradually fall back during the evening hours. Just a slight chance a sprinkle or two will show up across the area, especially north of Fort Wayne. Most of the rain is stuck to the north of us in Michigan and is not on a track to impact us here. So in your hour-by-hour forecast for us here this evening, you can see we'll drop down into the mid-40s at 6 with a temperature of 45. By the time we get to midnight, we'll be in the low 40s. We'll fall to the 30s overnight. Your 10-day forecast later on.
All right, thanks, Nicholas. Coming up on First at 5, another name is added to the list of those accused of abusing a minor. We'll give you that person's background.
Plus, Electric Works gets the go-ahead. We'll tell you how securing local funds made it possible.
Local coverage you can count on continues with Tara Brantley and Dirk Rowley. You're watching Wayne 15 News, First at 5.
Months after the original list of accused sexual abusers in the local Catholic Church was made public, another name was released today.
The Fort Wayne South Bend Diocese has announced a credible allegation against Gerald Funchen. Funchen began serving as a teacher and athletic director near Syracuse in 1965. He left the area in 1975. All told, the diocese says 21 men have been credibly accused of sexual abuse.
A vote this morning clears the way for the Electric Works project. The Capital Improvement Board voted unanimously to approve funding for that project. This means that all local and state funding has now been secured. Early construction is expected to begin this coming June. Today's funding agreement vote was the last in a series of six required approvals, which included city and county councils.
New Haven is one of the safest cities in the state, according to a new study. Safewire.com compiled the list of 20 cities. The evaluation is based on the number of reported violent crimes, such as aggravated assault, murder, rape, and robbery in each city. Half of the cities on the list saw less than one violent crime per 1,000 people based on the most recent FBI crime report. Indianapolis and Fort Wayne did not make that list. New Haven came in at number 20. The top four cities are St. John, Fishers, Carmel, and Crown Point.
Nicholas, I hoped the wind would blow the leaves into my neighbor's yard. Didn't really work that way.
No, that never happens, does it?
I wouldn't say that.
Oh, you have better luck.
I've had a little luck.
Wow,
yeah.
Well, we have to find out your magic trick. Okay, in our weather world, we're still windy, but not much rain to speak of at present. Later in the week, we have a chance to see some snowflakes. I'll let you know when after this.
Local coverage you can count on continues with Chief Meteorologist Nicholas Ferrari's live Doppler 15 Fury forecast.
We have been windy all day long and conditions are still windy out there this evening. Take a look at our peak wind reports that have come in so far today. In Fort Wayne, our highest gust up to 46 miles per hour. In Huntington, 42. Bluffton, 39 miles per hour. Bryan, 36. Warsaw, 35 miles per hour for you. Sustained winds here throughout the evening could still range anywhere from 20 to 30 miles per hour. Most spots will be a little bit lower than that. And as we head overnight, there will be a gradual relaxation of our wind speeds, although there still will be a noticeable breeze out there. During the day tomorrow, the wind speeds pick up again, but it won't be as windy as today has been. Our highest wind speed sustained tomorrow will be up to around 15 to 20 miles per hour, but we could still have gusts up to 25 miles per hour. Our temperature sits right around 50, and you can see those winds blowing in strongly now from the west-southwest at 32 miles per hour. Temperatures across the region are in the 40s in many spots, 46 in LaGrange and Angola, 46 also in Columbia City and Huntington. We've had some occasional rain showers today. Our chance here during the evening is low. I place it at about 20%. Most of the rain is to our north. The system that's brought us the cloud cover today and also these rain chances is centered well to the northeast, and it's starting to move away. Here on Futurecast tonight, you can see how the clouds hang around as we move into late night and get into early morning. Temperatures as tomorrow begins will be down in the mid-30s, 35 are low in Fort Wayne. Then during the day tomorrow, some scattered clouds in the morning, but some sun too. But there will be fewer clouds around during the afternoon, so even more sunshine then. But there's not much of a warm-up coming our way. A chill will still be in the air. At 8 in the morning, 36. At 10, 39. At noon, 42. At 2 o'clock, 44. Then at 4 o'clock, 46. And 46 is about as good as it'll get tomorrow. Thursday, a little bit colder, 44. On Friday, we have a chance at some scattered snow showers, 42. Saturday, lots of sunshine, but a cold day, 36. Sunday, 40. Monday, back down into the 30s with a high of 36. Tuesday, some snow showers, 33 only. Wednesday, lots of sun, 34. Then we're back to the 40s by a week from Thursday. That's your forecast. We have more news after this.
This week on the 2-Minute Money Plan, we're talking about avoiding higher taxes in retirement. Greg Reynolds of Reynolds Wealth Management is our financial expert. Joins us every Tuesday on First at 5. Greg, always good to see you. This is one of those things where essential planning is very essential.
Absolutely it is. You know, regardless of the size of your nest egg, big or small, the one common denominator is Uncle Sam is going to want his piece of that pie.
So how do you accomplish this goal?
Well, I think at its most basic level, you can think of this as a bucket-type strategy. Three different buckets of money are really, really important to have available to you entering and through retirement in order to not only optimize that income stream, but also to reduce taxes to the lowest common denominator.
Tell us about those buckets.
So the first bucket is basically a taxable bucket of income. It would consist of bank accounts and non-qualified brokerage accounts. The second bucket is a deferred bucket that would consist of, you know, 401k and traditional Roth or traditional IRAs. And the third bucket would be after tax. So it still may be 401k or IRA, but most likely of the Roth variety. A combination of income sources from all of those buckets can really allow you not only to optimize that stream of income, but to truly control your tax destiny.
And this is something you have to plan early on about.
It takes quite a bit of planning. Often it takes years of accumulation in these various sources to have a meaningful or impactful amount of money there that can allow you to truly shape that retirement income destiny.
So if currently you only have one bucket, you definitely need to talk to somebody to set up that plan.
This is a fantastic opportunity then to talk to an advisor, somebody to work with that can help you devise that strategy, to start allocating funds to these various other buckets, and to know really kind of what dollar amounts you need in each of these sources in order to be able to not only optimize that stream of income, but to do that through your entire retired career.
And it certainly would pay off in the long run.
It absolutely will, and the sooner you can get started, the better.
All right, good advice as always, Greg. Thank you for that. For more information about making sound financial decisions, you can contact Greg Reynolds at Reynolds Wealth Management. Next Tuesday on First at 5, we'll tackle another topic on the 2-Minute Money Plan. And be sure to join me along with Alyssa, Greg, and Michael on First News tomorrow morning between 5 and 7 a.m. We'll be right back.
On this election day, it's so windy, voters were literally blown to the polls.
Yes. Well, get them in the doors there, Mother Nature said.
Yeah.
Okay, here's a 10-day forecast. I can tell you tomorrow's still a windy day, but it's not going to be as windy as today has been. Our high tomorrow, 46. On Thursday, 44. By Friday, our high drops a couple more degrees down to 42. But the story at that point will be the fact that we'll have a weather system dropping by that's going to bring us a few scattered snow showers. Not looking at much right now in terms of accumulation, but it will remind us that the seasons are changing.
I took your advice and put the coat in the cleaner.
Good.
See you at 6 when the polls close.